Around the World with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor, Chief Medical Correspondent. Here at ACTRIMS 2016, the focus has been progressive multiple sclerosis. But we've also heard about relapsing MS, but we've also heard about a special part of relapsing MS, which is high disability multiple sclerosis. That's why I'm so excited to be joined once again by Dr. Mark Freedman, who is Professor of Neurology at University of Ottawa and Senior Scientist in Ottawa Hospital Research Institute. Thank you so much for joining us.
Always good, Dave.
You presented data on a medication called Interferon beta-1a. Tell us about the data that you presented.
Well, obviously, interferon beta-1a is not a new thing to MS, but we were interested in looking back at a cohort of patients, which I think is very unusual and different when you look at the patient population that we're dealing with today. This is the patients that enrolled in Prisms and Spectrums back in the early 90s.
Okay.
We don't see these patients today because most patients are being diagnosed after one or two attacks. The average patient that went into these studies had disease from 7 to 10 years, unchecked, untreated. And so we had a group of people who would be at the higher EDSS levels already coming into these studies. And by all terms today, if we looked back at that population, we'd say, wow, they're more like progressive MS patients than they were like relapsing patients. So we took the patients who were common to this relapsing progressive kind of phase from the two studies that represented most of the patients that were in the PRISM's relapsing remitting study and a segment of the patients who were in the secondary progressive study who were in this EDSS range 4 to 6, which would, one would argue is clearly a progressive phase. And ask the question, really, not only what happened to them, but whether or not there was an effect at interferon. Because if you ask the average physician today, you got a patient who's sort of relapsing progressive MS, who came out of the woods because they didn't know about therapy, and they show up in your office for the first time, would you ever consider an interferon for a treatment of such a patient? I think the average physician would say, well, why would I do that?
Right.
They have such advanced disease, it's not going to work. Well, in fact, it did. If you looked at the data, it was just as effective or even more effective in this group of patients who were advancing, which today would be considered fairly advanced patients. It's reminding us that therapies that we've had around for 25 years that we deemed effective years back are still very much effective, and what they have in favor of them compared to a lot of the newer ones is they're safe. And their safety is really unrivaled compared to today's therapies.
And I think that's an important topic to talk about. We often, when we're talking doctor to doctor, we talk about high efficacy drugs and taking risks. And we're taking risks not with ourselves, it's with our patients.
Of course we are.
And every person has a different risk averseness. So what you did is you looked at data from a medication that's commonly used called interferon beta-1a, subcutaneous, 3 times a week, also known as Rebif or Rebif, depending on what part of the world you're in. And you found that people with high disability still responded very well to the medication.
Absolutely. And there are many parts of the world where some of the newer medicines are simply not available or they're just beyond the reach of most patients because of their expense. Interferons are still what have to consider relatively cheap compared to some of the newer ones, and their safety is a big concern. So these are drugs that we know people can take for 10, 20 years and not get into any trouble.
Well, Dr. Freedman, I want to thank you so much once again for joining MS World. Thank you once again for sharing important information with people back home.
Thanks very much, Dan.